All right, what is going on, everybody? Welcome to tonight's J-League match between USC and Resting Butcherface. This is a Pro Division match, so I am very much looking forward to this. It will be 2 out of 3 because it is the Pro Division match. So we are going ahead and getting the first game all set up. The J-League site said that it was Infernal Shrines, but apparently Resting Butcherface, they get first pick, and they apparently want Braxis, so I'm going to go ahead and change that up and restart the lobby here. So this should be a fairly good match between these two Pro Division teams. I believe Resting Butcherface is 3-3, and I believe USC is 1-1. So both teams fairly even in terms of their standings. Kind of in the middle of the Pro Division, but it is still the Pro Division. These still are two very good teams going at it tonight. So I'm very much looking forward to this match. Curious if we'll see some Samuro tonight, considering that he does seem to be fairly broken. I believe he's currently sitting at a 65% win rate at the moment on Hot Slogs, which is just a tad on the strong side. I was kind of surprised that we didn't see him at all in the match I casted last night. But he was newly released, maybe no one had him yet, maybe no one knew just how strong he was, but does seem to be quite strong. So I'm just going ahead and getting teams all set up here in the lobby. And hopefully we should be good to go. Let's see here. Let's get the stream up here on my phone so I can watch the chat. So, just waiting on the rest of USC to all file into the lobby here. Let's see. Okay, looks like they're all being invited in now, so should be good to go here fairly soon. Not sure what USC stands for. I don't know if it's University of Southern California, University of South Carolina, or if there's anything or if it's something else, something special. But Resting Butcherface, I'm already liking things for them tonight. They have the icon synergy going on, portrait synergy. All Butcher. But strangely enough, I don't think they play Butcher much in their cheerleading games, so very misleading title. I was happy that I casted Calamity a couple nights ago, which is a Division I team. And they actually picked Li Ming with Calamity, so I always enjoy seeing good hero talent team name synergy. So we have 4 members in for USC, but I think we're good to go ahead and start the draft. So I'm gonna go ahead and try and get this going here. Yeah, we should be good to go here. Yeah, once again, this is a Pro Division team. This will be 2 out of 3. So, very much looking forward to this. All right, draft links are going out. Just got to go ahead here and do my little whispering of the captain's links, and we should be good to go. All right. Once again, it looks like the Charlie draft interface getting some more visual polish. Looking very, very nice. Super Joe has really done a great job with this. Yeah, I can see one of the changes from yesterday. Now the map name, the text is right there under the icon, so much easier to tell which map is actually being drafted on. But draft links has been given out, so we're just waiting on both teams to Okay, so Rusty and Butcherface is ready. Just waiting on USC to ready up. So this is Braxis. I think usually what you see on this map is you see a strong solo laner in the top and then a strong format on the bottom. And this map is very much about sustained fights. So supports who are very mana efficient, very important. So, in terms of support, someone like Ariel, Brightwing, Malfurion. Not Uther. But then you don't see a lot of, you don't really see a lot of pick heroes on this map, so not a lot of, Kerrigan. But Zarya will be first banned by USC, and then Samuro will be banned by Rusty and Butcherface, so... So far, no Samuro, but he does seem to be very, very strong at the moment, so not at all surprising to me to see him banned out here in this first round. So first pick for USC, Malfurion on the table, but they decided to go with Sylvanas. And assuming USC is able to get a lead and get at least decent-sized Zerg Wave, Sylvanas can really enhance the pushing power of that Zerg Wave. But nothing particularly special about Sylvanas in terms of actually winning the point. Sure, she has her ability. She does damage and everything, but not super strong when it comes to a team fight. So, Rusty and Butcherface, I really like these two picks from them. They pick up Malfurion. I think he's still the strongest support in the game at the moment. It does seem to have dropped a little bit in terms of his win percentage in this latest patch. Not sure why. He hasn't really been nerfed or anything. But tremendous amount of sustain in both his Q and his ability to innervate his allies, give them mana, reduce their cooldowns. So they got Malfurion, and they have Rek'Sai, who can very easily soul the top lane. Then Alarak and ETC picked up for USC. I like these two picks as well. They could have Alarak soul the top lane. They could have him go toe-to-toe with Rek'Sai, but... Yeah, I think some people are a little torn about that. It's like, yes, Alarak can solo lane, but is that the best use of his talents? Is that really getting maximum value out of him? So we may see USC like to draft someone else to solo top lane, maybe a Thrall? So Ahri will be banned out by Rusty and Butcherface. So far, they have a pretty good... they're really winning, I think, the support battle at the moment. They have Malfurion, who is a very strong support and very very good sustain on this map. And they ban out Ariel, who is a manaless support. So assuming she has a good battery, she can very, very... she can sustain very, very well on this map. So I like the ban of Ariel. Plus, Lunara is still on the table. someone who can really feed her a lot of energy very efficiently. So one more ban here for USC. Could ban out a... they could ban out a warrior. So they have Rexxar, Wrestling Butcherface. They have Rexxar who can soul the top lane, but they still need a warrior for the bottom lane. Someone who can really help dominate that four man. And it will be Murden banned out. So USC wisely choosing to ban out a warrior. Which I think is very good. They already have one picked up for themselves. So, Wrestling Butcherface, they pick up Vala. Who is, I think, is very good on this map. You know, she puts out a lot of sustained damage, and sustain is what you want on this map. And given that you're fighting around such a small area, it's very easy for her to keep her hatred stacks up. There's usually some minion she can go auto to keep her hatred stacks going. And then usually there's someone around the point trying to contest it. So she can very, very easily keep her hatred stacks up. And it really put out a ton of damage, ton of sustained damage. So it is going to be Brightwing as the support for USC. Really like Brightwing on this map. I think that is an excellent pickup for USC. Brightwing doesn't necessarily need any mana to heal. Just have Blink heal, and if she takes Mistfight at 7, she can kind of spam her abilities to trigger her trait and put out a lot of healing. And it will be Gul'dan for USC. So we could see Gul'dan go toe-to-toe with Rexxar in the top lane, which I think you can very easily do. But then that'll allow them to have Alarak in the foreman, who can be very, very devastating. So one more pick here for Wrestling Butcherface. Probably... maybe a mage. I'm kind of thinking maybe Li Ming. I think Li Ming would pair up very well with Malfurion. Yeah, Malfurion helps her out with her very, very slight mana problems, but also lets her, thanks to Innervate, allows her to throw out a lot more arcane orbs than normal. So Wrestling Butcherface, they still have all of their time pool left, so they could take their time with this last pick. And they have a good 50 seconds here. They're in no hurry. But they have Vala who can do a lot of sustained damage, and having someone to just finish people off once Vala gets them low, very useful. And it will be Li Ming. I am a prophet. So I think USC, I think they do have a very strong four-man with Brightwing, Alarak, ETC, and Sylvanas. And if they're able to get a pick and really fully secure the bottom beacon, Brightwing can fly top to Gul'dan and help him out. And basically turn that 1v1 in the top lane into a 2v1. So then hopefully you're controlling both beacons at that point. But looking at this draft, I think Wrestling Butcherface, they have a very strong draft as well. I'm not sure who wins in lane between Rexxar and Gul'dan. I think it's going to come down to winning the four-man and then Brightwing coming to assist Gul'dan to kind of force Rexxar off the point. But yeah, everyone is readied up. That was very quick. As to be expected from two pro teams. Very professional. These guys know what they're doing. Hey, here we go. Game number one between USC and Wrestling Butcherface. So for USC, it is going to be In Terms Of on Gul'dan, Soul Reaper on Sylvanas, Zedalve on Brightwing, Tom on ATC, and Blackfeath on Alarak. And for Wrestling Butcherface, it will be Siege Train on Rexxar, Harry Augie on Malfurion, Rimaka on Vala, Twami on Johanna, and Nidhi, I'm going to go with, on Li Ming. Once again, excellent portrait synergy on the side of Wrestling Butcherface, although no Butcher on their side, which is a little bit disappointing to see. But I'll settle for all Butcher portraits. That's good enough for me. You know, it's actually the level 6 portrait, I believe, for the Butcher. I don't believe it's the... would have liked to see the Master Butcher portrait for them, which I think you need to get Butcher to level 9 to achieve, but... I'll allow it. It's fine. So, I'm anticipating seeing Rexxar up in the top lane. Probably going to toe-to-toe with Gul'dan. But so far it looks like maybe Alaric posturing to go top. Which I think is acceptable. Systems online. It can really be good for Gul'dan to pair up with the support. So the support can heal him, which he can basically use to turn into mana. Which he can use to devastate his opponents. So far it looks like it's going to be a 5-man party bush here in the bottom. Well, maybe not a party bush, but... Actually, scratch that. Looks like Alarak going to be rotating up into the top. So, looks like it will be him and Rexxar up on the top. Rexxar, who is positioned up here, has Misha scouting out the bush, so... knows he's not in danger of being pounced on by 5 members of USC. You know what? It will be a 4-on-4 down here in the bottom. We saw Malfurion go for Moonburn as opposed to Shondo's Clarity. So, not going to be able to innervate quite as often, but he's going to be able to wave clear much better. I believe Moonburn doubles the effectiveness of Moonfire on creeps, and more importantly, the Zerg Wave. So, Johanna going to use her Iron Skin to get out of trouble there. And so far, I mean, it's a slight advantage here for Resting Butchface. Looks like their wave clear is a little bit better. Meanwhile, up top, not too much going on up here. Misha getting awfully low, but Misha is immortal. The combo comes out from Alarak, and Rexxar is getting awfully low. So Misha can be healed up very, very effectively, but Rexxar, on the other hand, pretty much any damage done to him is going to stick. Fortunately, the combo not quite going to connect from Alarak. But Rexxar has been very chunked. Looks like he does not have tap available, so Rexxar going to have to be very careful, especially now that Misha's gone down. So Rexxar actually going to have to hearth. Probably going to get all this XP here. Oh, looks like going to hearth before getting that XP. So we're going to see a slight advantage for USC in terms of XP. So far both beacons are being traded out. Bottom beacon being controlled by Resting Butchface, or his top. Going to go over to USC for the time being. So far, Alarak really dominating the top lane matchup. So we're seeing USC try to make a play here on this beacon, but the sustain from Resting Butcherface is just proving to be too much. ETC absolutely being chunked out. Going to have to back off for a little bit. In fact, he is going to hearth all the way back. And everyone getting awfully low on the side of USC. Meanwhile, up top, now that Rexxar has hearth, things are much more even. And if Misha is able to get on this point, that could be very bad for USC. Because once Misha is kind of planted on that point, it's very difficult to get her off. She's pretty much immortal. She's very hard to kill. So, Alarak basically is just going to have to sit on this point and battle the spirit. Meanwhile, Rexxar is soaking top. So got the kill on Misha, but probably missed a lot of the soak up there. So it's part of what makes Rexxar such a good top laner. He can control the point with Misha, and he can also soak the lane. So Rexxar very, very good on this map. So ETC getting in some trouble, probably going to have to power slide out, and he does. And this is bad. So Misha managed to get her little bear self onto the point. This could be very, very difficult for Alarak to wrestle her off. Manages to telekinesis her off, which is going to stop the beacons from charging. So very, very good play with him, but he is getting low and he is going to have to retreat. But managed to buy his team time. The four man on the bottom, able to wrestle control of the bottom beacon. So the sustained power of Gul'dan and Brightwing proving to be formidable for resting Butcher Face. But meanwhile, Johanna getting out of the point, getting very, very low, going to have to Iron Skin out of there. And Johanna is going to live. And control of the bottom point, still going to be in control of USC. So ETC trying to get out of the point, trying to make control of that beacon for just a little bit longer, but unable to hold that. Johanna, though, getting quite low. This is Malfurion, but then again, so is Gul'dan. Meanwhile, Alarak manages to pick off Rexxar, and just in the nick of time, too, because Resting Butcherface, they were just about to get that beacon, too, 100%. So, if they're able to control this bottom beacon as well, finally USC will be able to start charging both beacons. Meanwhile, we saw Vala rotate up. Not sure Alarak, not sure he knew that rotation was coming, but he has sniffed this out, manages to get back out of the point. I think that will go back under control. Yes, so top beacon goes back under control of USC. But it's not going to matter because both beacons fully charged by arresting Butcherface. And I believe their Zerg Wave will be pushing the top lane. And so far, a solid rotation up from USC to come up here and soak this. Meanwhile, we have ETC in the bottom, just kind of soaking the bottom lane. Trying to assist their Zerg Wave a little bit. Just so they can maybe get the wall. So far the top wall has gone down. Top fort wall has gone down. For USC. But I think they're going to be able to save this fort. Everyone getting awfully low on the side of Resting Butcherface, so they're forced to retreat. But Li Ming in some trouble, the Discord strike comes out from Alarak. But no follow-up, so Li Ming is going to survive. And so far, despite the superior Zerg wave, both teams pretty much even in XP, so I think USC has got to feel pretty good about that. And Alarak's managed to kill Rexxar, I believe, twice now. I guess just once. So I got to feel pretty good about things. So, both teams are approaching level 10. Level 9 picked up here for both teams. So, curious if we're going to see Stage Dive or Mosh Pit for ETC. Stage Dive does appear to be the new default, but on a small map like this, I think it definitely would not be at all surprised if Mosh Pit came out. So, Gul'dan being collapsed on. The root comes down from Malfurion, and that is going to secure the kill, so great pickoff here by Resting Butcherface. Yeah, we see the response from ETC and Brightwing. Just trying to come up here to fend everyone off of the fort and still can get the XP. So as usual, after the first beacons, both teams have gone ahead and picked up all of their camps. Meanwhile, it looks like Rexxar has switched to the bottom lane, and Alarak is right there with him. But Rexxar awfully low on mana, so I think he's probably going to have to back. Especially now that he doesn't have his bear. But no, Rexxar does have tap available, and Misha should be back alive here shortly. But control of the bottom beacon, going to go over to USC, where his top going to go to Resting Butcherface. So stalemate here for the time being. Level 10 has been reached by both teams. And ETC still deciding on an ultimate. Very interesting. And it looks like Li Ming doing the same as well. So she may be waiting to see if Mosh Pit comes out for ETC. In which case she's going to pick up Wave of Force. So ETC may be waiting till the last possible second. Right before he would do a Mosh Pit to actually lock it in. But once again, Alarak manages to kill Rexxar in the bottom lane, so Alarak really being a force to be reckoned with for Rexxar. So we may see Alarak come up here to the top and try and secure the top beacon as well. But Johanna getting awfully low. And ETC has locked in Mosh Pit, but not going to connect with anyone. And we do see Wave of Force also picked up for Li Ming. So ETC tried to be sneaky, but unable to pull that off. So despite having the numbers advantage, everyone awfully low on the side of USC and forced to back off. Alright, we are going to see control of both beacons go over to Resting Butcher Face. So, despite Alarak picking off Rexxar, unable to get a huge advantage off of that. And they're actually behind on XP. So it looks like we are going to see the Hellbats picked up as well. Or Firebats? I don't know, I'm not a StarCraft player, but Johanna getting off of the gets the heal from Malfurion, able to stay in there long enough to secure this point back. Meanwhile, what's going on the bottom? Misha is firmly planted on the point. We're going to have to retreat. I guess trying to go after Alarak, but he's going to get out of there. And once again, the Zerg wave goes in favor of Resting Butcherface. This time it is on the bottom. Which USC has got to be happy about, considering they just lost the top fort. I believe the beacon wave, the Zerg waves, they always flip. Despite whichever lane has the superior health in terms of their structures. So it's Uncle Dan, I believe, died to Vala, perhaps? And so far, this is not looking good for USC. Level 13 picked up for Resting Butcherface. And they're marching here on the keep with their Zerg wave. Still, I guess, not that healthy anymore, but probably going to get this keep wall. In fact, yeah, this tower definitely going down. Along with the gate. So, Gul'dan is up for USC. So, going to be able to come and help defend this keep, which don't expect to go down. Don't worry, I didn't see that corruption. So, I mean, everyone getting awfully low on the side of Resting Butcherface. The heal comes out from Malfurion, but he does not have any mana, so they absolutely cannot stay here any longer. Resting Butcherface, they're backing off. We see a little bit of a chase from USC, but unable to secure anyone. Johanna was positioned in the back, which is absolutely what you want. Which you want to have happen. You want your tank to be the last one to leave so that she can intercept anyone trying to chase and peel for your team. Yeah, I've seen very, very many Hero League matches where, you know, the tank is the first one to leave, and that is not what you want, folks. So, another Zerg wave has completed, so once again, we see camps being picked up. USC thinking about invading this camp, but no, they're not going to get there in time. Power Slide does not connect from ETC. But the Telekinesis does from Alarak, but Malfurion going to get away. And I think USC, like, I think this is a time where they really want to fight. Their uneven talent tiers are a little bit behind, but if they can find a good engagement and find a pick, like, maybe on Malfurion right here, that is absolutely what they want to get themselves back in the game. Yeah, they want to get some picks, get themselves some XP, maybe some structures. But if they can just get a little bit ahead, they can really get some value out of Sylvanas, which they're hoping to find right now. So Sylvanas going to disable this tower, and Li Ming getting absolutely chunked out. The power slide from ETC, I think some other ability he did, managed to finish her off. Vala, though, awfully low, but doing her best to peel for Johanna, who is going to get out of here. So just like that, USC is back in this game. And I think a lot of that comes due to the power of Sylvanas. They were able to find a pick. And then using the pushing power of Sylvanas, they were able to very, very easily get that fort. Because she was disabling the fort, Resting Butcherface wasn't really getting any protection from it. No one was being slowed. And that led to another pickoff for USC, who trying to get control of both beacons. Probably going to phase shift in. And so top is going to go to USC, but bottom going to go over to Wrestling Butcher Face. ETC unable to fend off three people on his own, which, shame on you, ETC, you should absolutely... No. That's very difficult to hold that against three. So, a mere 2% charge for USC. And for the meantime, going to have yet another stalemate. Although, top beacon being secured by a resting butcher face, but bottom beacon being secured by USC. The Twilight Dream comes out from Malfurion, but it's unable to save him. And he falls, as well as Vala. Johanna and a lot of troll pops the Iron Skin, so ETC cannot power slide her and keep her pinned down. But Misha going to be a major pain to deal with up here on the top beacon. So despite having a large numbers advantage, Misha can still fairly safely park herself there. And once again, despite the numbers advantage, no more charging for USC. Great denials of charging both beacons on the side of Wrestling Butcher Face. It looks like USC, they were wanting to grab those fire bats real quick, but unable to do so because Wrestling Butcher Face back up and really doing a tremendous job of denying USC from getting control of both beacons at the same time. So Brightwing getting absolutely chunked out, but uses a great blink heal to get out of trouble. Looks like Sylvanas has dropped, so maybe someone's going to pause. Okay. So hopefully Sylvanas there is coming right back. But I mean, so far, really, really, really good denials here from Wrestling Butcher Face. Despite them losing two members, thanks to the power of Rexxar and Misha, they're able to deny this top beacon for just long enough that I think Johanna was able to sneak down there and keep control of the bottom one. It's funny, you know, I see a lot of people say things like, "Oh, we got a group," and on a map like this, as long as you're careful and don't get picked off, grouping not always the best thing to do. Because if you're grouping, you're ceding control over one of the beacons to the other team, most likely. Meanwhile, I hope Sylvanas didn't go down there as a result of lag. But Sylvanas and Gul'dan going down, all right, in some trouble, manages to telekinesis himself away. Does a great job. So despite Rexxar being down, two members of USC fall. And we're seeing Li Ming go up to the top beacon to get control of that, and Malfurion in some trouble though, using the ice block, trying to juke some of the CC there. But Wrestling Butcherface going to get control of both of these beacons. The three-man squad manages to hold things off down here. But a big 5-on-4 invasion for USC, trying to get Johanna. Li Ming, awfully low, gets the heal from Malfurion. And Johanna going to go down. And that is, at the very least, going to prevent Wrestling Butcherface from the time being from getting to 100%. They're already 82% of the way there, so I mean, even if USC manages to get to 100%, they're still going to have a very strong Zerg wave to deal with. Even if theirs is a little bit stronger. So we see Misha denying this for just a little bit, and that gives the rest of her team time to rotate down and secure the bottom beacon. So once again, despite having a numbers advantage, unable to get both beacons charged is USC. So really great play here from Wrestling Butcher Face, which is what I would expect from two pro division level teams. So we see a rotation down here by USC, but once again, this top beacon going to be snatched up by Wrestling Butcher Face. So only 8% more charge for USC. Meanwhile, it looks like Johanna being collapsed on. The Chain CC, the Polymorph, the Power Slide. It's not going to be enough to finish her off as the rest of the team has all shown up. Actually, Johanna does going down. A four-man mosh pit from ETC. Vala falls. That is a near wipe. Only Li Ming is alive. And I, you know what? I think this is finally going to be enough dead on the side of Resting Butcher Face. That USC finally going to be able to charge both these beacons and get 100% Zerg wave. And they're not content to just, you know, I expect them to pull back and get boss. No? Okay, yeah, it looks like they are. Someone was pinging the Firebats camp, but... No, okay, they're actually going to get the Bruiser camp? Is that what it's called in this map? I don't even know. Thought they might pull back and get boss, but that timer is not quite enough to justify that. Will be a little risky. Plus, I mean, when Li Ming is up, if one person gets low around the boss, Li Ming can very easily finish them off, and which can lead to a reset chain, which can just devastate your team. The telekinesis from behind the wall almost manages to secure the kill on Li Ming, but just very able to get out of there. So Sylvanas going to be rooted. Misha ends up going down. The telekinesis comes in on Vala, but able to get out of there. So far, everyone very low on the side of USC. Going to have to back off. Brightwing's heals takes a little bit for her to get everyone up to full health, so really just kind of need to kite back a little bit. Johanna, though, goes down thanks to the Discord strike from Alarak. And once again, the power of Sylvanas is showing. Once you finally are able to secure a good wave for yourself, Sylvanas can be absolutely devastated. So this entire keep has gone down. And without Johanna, Resting Butcherface has to be very, very careful here. They don't have anyone to peel. Well, they have Misha, who's about to go down. But no, the very, very difficult to kill Misha. Was in danger, but the Mend Pet comes out from Rexxar. So it looks like USC choosing to back off. It's very, very difficult to take down the core unless you have some major pushing pressure. They've also got to be very careful because their own core is actually in danger from the Zerg wave. It's already going down to 48%. And Sylvanas had to back, which means this is a 4-on-4 at best. ETC going to power slide out of there. But Gul'dan in the back. So what I was just saying before about you usually want the tank to be in the back. I mean, that's kind of like a prime example. But of course, ETC couldn't really do that because he himself was low. So... Yeah, you're definitely in a bit of a pickle there. So, Resting Butcherface, they have a 5-on-4. They have a weak keep, and the core is weak on the side of USC, so they're at the very least going to come and sneeze on that keep, finish it off. Malfurion, though, in a lot of trouble. Great ice block to dodge the deadly charge from Alarak, but not going to be able to evade the rest of that. So, Malfurion has gone down. So far, a 4-on-4. But not really going to be able to push core or a keep with a 4-on-4. Meanwhile, USC's got to be really careful here. This is a 2-on-4. Which, I mean, I would be a little surprised too on USC. I mean, you think 4-on-4, if it's a 4-on-4, you're not expecting your camps to be invaded necessarily. So maybe feel a little bit safe about splitting up and getting camps, but... Thankfully for them, they were able to get out of there. Juke the invasion. So Alarak scouting out the boss, making sure Resting Butcherface isn't doing anything too sneaky. So a phase shift in from Brightwing. Alarak getting awfully low. The Counter-Strike comes out, which is going to keep him safe for the time being. But Rexxar in a lot of trouble. The Feign Death comes out. That is going to give his team time to come and maybe save him. No, but Rexxar going to get out of there. But ETC going to fall as well. So far, a 1-for-1. Ice Block comes out from Malfurion. And Alarak going to go down. Malfurion and Vala have no health. And the heal comes in just in time for Vala. So far, an absolutely crazy fight that has gone in favor of Resting Butcherface. Li Ming, though, goes down, which is absolutely huge. So basically that meant instead of being having a 4-on-2, now it's just a 3-on-2, which is, I mean, you could probably still safely secure both beacons, but it's not quite the core pushing numbers you need. So control of both beacons and control of resting butcher face. So USC really has to force something here. It's going to be hard with Johanna here on the point. She's going to buy enough time for her team to show up. We see Vala and Malfurion racing in, coming to help. And the Reign of Vengeance comes in from Vala, kills off Sylvanas, and I think that is going to be game. Yeah, both beacons fully charged for resting Butcher Face. And Li Ming going to be up momentarily, but Sylvanas going to be down for the count. Probably not going to be up in time to try and save this. But we're about to see some of the power of Gul'dan here. He's very, very good against the Zerg waves. So, I mean, basically he can drain health from the big things and fell flame the crap out of the little ones. But if he gets rooted and condemned and focused by Vala, he's not really going to be able to do anything. And that is going to be GG. So unless something miraculous here happens, game one going to go to resting Butcherface. And a deadly charge comes in from Alarak, goes on to Rexxar, but he's just going to feign death, avoid everything. That is going to be game. All right, so that is game one for Resting Butcherface. I really think that came down to just superior play. On the side of Resting Butcherface, we saw Alarak do honestly a lot of work. He was able to win a lot of the fights against Rexxar and others, but Resting Butcherface, they were just too good at denying USC from charging both beacons, and which really prevented Sylvanas from getting a lot of value. I think that's really what it came down to. Just really, really good, really, really good play by USC. Resting Butcherface. That is going to give them a 1-0 advantage. So I'm going to find out what team USC would like now. And we shall get game number two here started. So far off to a very good start. So trying to figure out what team USC wants, and it will be Blackheart's Bay. So I'm going to go ahead and get that all set up. I hope it is Blackheart's Bay. That's a fun map. I like that map. Okay, so just going ahead and getting the lobby all set up here. And we should be good to go. So what I like about Resting Butcherface is that it's very easy to tell who should be on what team in the lobby thanks to the butcher icons. Makes my job very easy. Okay, so draft is beginning here for game number two. My favorite thing to do over the past couple days is, you know, in Hero League, whenever one of these quote-unquote new maps come up, I just like to be like, is this a new map? Blackheart's Bay? Is this new? Okay, so just giving out the draft links to both teams. Yeah, we should be good to go. Draft links have been given out. So, this is Blackheart's Bay. Oops. Okay, there we go. So, this is Blackheart's Bay. Could see the return of some heroes which have not been in the meta too much, just because they're very good on this map. Maybe some Illidan, maybe some Sonya, maybe some Zul. I know I'm a big fan of Zul on this map. Just because, I mean, he can rotate between the top two lanes. And, basically free up the rest of the team to do whatever they want. They can push lanes, they can get camps. But going to finally be able to drink some of my nice decaf coffee here, which has gotten fairly cold. Oh, that's good. Yeah, I thought that was a very good Vala. Very good Vala. Well done to Rimaka. Yeah, I thought there was a lot of very, very good play on the side of Resting Butcher Face and USC. Okay, so the draft has begun. We are just waiting. Let's see here. I believe Resting Butcher Face has first pick, first ban. And they're going to first ban Samuro. I think it's Samuro because it's supposed to be like Samurai with an O. And then it will be Zarya banned out for USC. So, could see Malfurion here picked up for Resting Butcherface. No, it will be Zul. Hey, once again, I really like Zul on this map. I think he's very, very strong here. So, he can rotate between the top and mid lanes, which eventually is going to wear down the cannon towers. They're going to run out of ammo very quickly. So, I mean, those cannon towers are going to go down pretty much for free. And then you start pressuring the forts, and usually you're a little bit behind in terms of the turn-ins because you have Zul doing that and not really focusing on the chests and camps at all. But by the time you do turn in, because you've already done all that free damage to the top and mid structures, you get a lot more value out of each turn-in. So I really like Zul on this map. But Malfurion, you're going to be picked up by USC. And Murden. So Murden banned out last game, going to make an appearance in this game. So two more picks here for Resting Butcherface. So because they have Zul, they might want to also grab someone who can get the camps. Maybe an Illidan, maybe a Sonya. But if you have a Zul, I don't know if you necessarily need someone to do that, because the rest of the team can do that as a four-man. But it will be Sylvanas picked up on this map. And I actually think that's very strong. So if you have Zul soaking the mid and top lanes, the rest of the team can push his four. And if you have Sylvanas in that four-man group pushing, that is a very, very strong... That is a very, very strong four-man. And that is something that absolutely has to be responded to. And Johanna picked up as well. For Wrestling Butcher Face. I don't know about the Johanna pick. So the things that are good about Johanna, she has good wave clear. But you already have Zul, so don't necessarily need the wave clear. But she also has blinds, and so far I don't see any blind targets for USC. But they may have someone who's very comfortable on Johanna, plays her very well. So it is going to be Brightwing banned out by USC and Illidan banned out by Wrestling Butcher Face. So don't want to deal with the camp pressure that Illidan can put on them. And USC, because they're banning up Brightwing, maybe looking to pick up some kind of dive hero. Possibly Butcher, possibly Sonya. And Brightwing can really make things troublesome for them when they try to dive the back line. But so far it will be Kael'thas for USC. And I do like the combination of Kael'thas and Malfurion, but I think this is such an open map that I don't think it's Kael'thas' strongest map, but USC may be able to make it work. But Vala picked up for them as well. So Morales picked up for USC and Sergeant Hammer. So if Wrestling Butcherface is moving as a four man, I mean, Morales, I think is definitely one of the heroes you want in that, just because she can sustain single targets so well. And Morales and Hammer is just a nightmare to deal with. And one of the ways you kill Morales and Hammer is to dive them. And not seeing too much in terms of dive heroes for USC. They have Murden who can do it. But, you know, KT not really a dive hero. Vala not really a dive hero. But USC, they need a bruiser. So they could maybe think about picking up someone here who can really disrupt the Morales Hammer combo. Maybe a Thrall. Maybe Sonya. So one more pick here for USC. And it'll be Greymane. Interesting. So Greymane can definitely dive the back line, but doesn't necessarily have the CC to kind of pin them down. But of course Murden does. So if Murden can basically get on Morales and slow her and use a Storm Bolt to interrupt her healing, then I think I give Greymane an opportunity to really get some stuff done. So for Wrestling Butcherface, I think we're going to see Zul in the mid and top lanes. And then a four-man push with Sylvanas, Johanna, and Morales and Hammer, which it's going to be very difficult to deal with. I mean, USC is probably going to need everyone except Kael'thas to go deal with it. They'll probably have KT soak the top and two lanes, go toe-to-toe with Zul. KT does have excellent wave clear. Oh. Someone was right. Okay, whatever. Game glitched. But they're probably going to have KT go match Azul and then have everyone else try and shut down the Hammer Morales combo. But here we are. It's time for game number two between USC and Wrestling Butcherface. So for USC, it is in terms of on Vala, Soul Reaper on Greymane, Zadalve on Malfurion, Tom on Murden, and Apocalypse on Kael'thas. And for the side of Wrestling Butcherface, who are not all using their butcher portraits, that's strange. But it's going to be Harry Augie on Morales, Nidhi on Sylvanas, Twami on Johanna, Siege Train on Zul, and Rimaka on Sergeant Hammer. So two Greymanes, two Butchers, one Kael'thas, I don't I don't understand that. So I'm going to be very curious to see if we see some kind of tower cheese here on the side of Rusty and Butcher Face, considering they have Sylvanas and Sergeant Hammer and Morales. But as expected, it looks like we are going to see Zul go up to the top lane. Looks like it will be Greymane going toe-to-toe with him. Would have expected to maybe see Greymane go with the four-man to try and dive Morales and Hammer, but maybe wait until more of the late game to do that. So, strong response here from USC. You know, I think they anticipate what's coming. So, they send four bottom, then just leave Greymane top. So, both teams being very cautious, just hiding in the bushes. But in comes Johanna into the entirety of the other team. But she's going to have Morales behind her. So she's going to be fine. So far, like, levels 1 to 10, I think this is extremely difficult to deal with. It usually takes some talents, some heroics, just to have the dive that it takes to basically disrupt a Morales-Hammer duo. And because Rusty and Butcherface, because they have this early game advantage, that's really going to snowball, thanks to the fact that they have Zul. So far, I know I don't have any stories. Oh, I guess I have a little bit of one, which is just going to go to you guys on the stream and no one in the game. But, you know, I was playing some quick match earlier, and the other team had Samuro and Nova on it, and just I was Zarya. I would see like so many bodies, and I would fire off my graviton surge, just thinking like, yeah, so many people here. Surely one of these must be a real enemy member. Should get some kills here. And I think like hit three decoys with it, and just, oh my god. Samuro seems to be just pure cancer to deal with. Very, very difficult. Yeah, I mean, thanks to his advancing strikes, I mean, he can really chase people down. And then as soon as he hits someone, he can split up into his mirror images, in which case it's pretty much it's very, very difficult to tell which one is the real one. I think he can just stealth and run away if he gets into trouble. Alright, but it looks like everyone is ready to go here. It's like Kael'thas going to be coming back. I know this game lags me out a ton. Alright, here we go. So we're back in the way here. Tom, not going to be able to get away on Muradin. Which means that I think this bottom chest going to go freely to Rusty and Butcherface. There's some of them even care about it, which I'm not even sure they do. I think they're just focused on zoning out and taking down these towers. Meanwhile, Zul, not even really caring about this top chest. So far, that might be the least amount of focus I've ever seen on chests in any game of Black Hearts Bay ever. But, you know, both teams very clearly having a strategy, just sticking to it. Not getting distracted by things like map objectives. But Murden back for USC. So going to put a slight end to this push here, but the entire minion wave has been deleted for USC. And this top cannon tower is already out of ammo. Meanwhile, Hammer going to siege up, get another shot or two. You know, I think I understand why KT is with the four-man now. The range he gets from his flame strike is very, very good against Hammer. You know, Hammer does not exactly the best mobility in the world. So she is kind of forced to sit there, and KT likes it when you just sit there, because then he can then he gets drop his combo on you. But Valo getting awfully low, going to go down. The vault unable to save her. And so far this entire bottom wall has gone down for USC, and they're now down a level and then some. Meanwhile, Zul is putting a lot of pressure on the top two lanes, so these cannon towers are almost out of ammo. And a little bit healthier on the top, but that's going to change when Zul gets up here and makes some more skeletons. But Grayman just does not have the wave clear to keep up with Zul. It looks like Zul actually entirely gave up the top chest to Grayman. Even though, as I recall, the chest spawned much closer to him, so very interesting. So far, both teams have traded out their coins. Wrestling Butcherface does have get the bottom chest, and Grayman on USC got the top chest. So Safeguard and Healing Beam going to be enough to keep Sergeant Hammer alive and a little bit of danger. So Morales is getting awfully low on mana, so either going to have to tap or Hearth all the way back. So it's choosing a Hearth. So going to have to give up this dominance for the time being. So meanwhile, Zul up top doing Zul things. Puts Grayman in the Bone Prison, and pretty much just to be like, hey, just leave me alone. You stay over there while I make these skeletons. Yeah, once again, putting Grayman in the Bone Prison and just using that as a kind of as a way to kind of peel for himself. And yeah, not surprisingly, it looks like Zul went with only Shade because wants to be able to evade Grayman's autos. And he also went for the mana and health talent. So basically every time he goes and kills a minion, makes a skeleton, he's going to get mana and health back, which is really going to help him sustain in this top and mid rotation. Basically, if you don't take those talents, it's very, very hard to pull this off without running out of mana. So, especially, just let Zul stay in lane forever. And meanwhile, bottom fort goes down to this strong four-man squad, and they're also going to pick up the chest, too. And they don't have enough for a turn-in, and looks like they're going to choose to try and do that now. Thought maybe they might wait a little bit for Zul to get a little more value out of this, but so far, Grayman doing a great job of keeping these towers healthy. They're running out of ammo, but they haven't really taken too much in terms of damage, so basically, these cannons aren't going to get a fort, which is a big win for USC right now. But those cannons are going to take out this wall and this well, so poor Grayman and KT going to have an even tougher time against Zul. Meanwhile, we see the rest of the four man choosing to pull back at camps.
Well then, who's got the coin for me service?
And let's see, where are they headed now? I would be pretty surprised if they chose to approach this bottom keep, but the grenade comes out trying to knock Muradin back into the team. One of my favorite things to do with the new Morales. Not really all that new though, just kind of that one change. But looks like we're going to see them start to pressure this keep wall. And with only three to defend this, I mean, this cannon tower is definitely going down. And so far, not seeing a response from Greymane or KT, so already, I mean, we're 6.5 minutes into this game, and this keep is being threatened. And I think this keep is guaranteed to go down. Grayman coming down to try and save it, but not going to get there before Murden goes down. So this is still a 3-on-4. And the bottom keep is going down. And so far we're seeing a gigantic advantage for Resting Butcherface. Medivac comes out. Let's see, where are they headed? So they're coming up here. They're trying to, now they're trying to take down the mid keep, I think. Maybe thought they had a pick on KT. But now it looks like they're going to just pull back, get their turn in. So they're already at level 12. Meanwhile, level 10 just reached for USC. So Johanna going to zone out long enough for Morales to get the turn in. And Johanna doing a very good job. She could have gone that way, in which case she would have been split from Morales. So doing a very good job of not splitting up, staying with the team. But meanwhile, the first turn in for USC. But even though they got that turn in, level 13 picked up for Wrestling Butcher Face. So, I mean, yeah, they got the turn in, but still at a big disadvantage. Meanwhile, Zul going absolutely ham on this top wall. Going to use the Bone Prison to try and peel Murden off of him. And Wrestling Butcher Face, they are turning hardcore on USC. Greymane gets awfully low, but Sylvanas getting awfully low herself. Really needs some heals from Morales to stay in this fight. But while this fight going on, we actually saw Johanna go and sneak those coins there. And Vala actually going down. So 4-on-5, they managed to take down Vala in front of the enemy fort. Yeah, I mean, that's one of the luxuries of being up 2 to 3 levels at a talent tier. You just have such a strong advantage in team fights. But Johanna getting awfully low. Really needs the heals from Morales. Going to get them. Greymane getting awfully low. He goes down. And the chase is on. Stormbolt comes down on Sylvanas, but she's going to get the medic on her. She is going to be fine. And that is a 2-for-nothing trade. Morales thinking about going back, but just thinking about Morales, like even with very little mana, she can be a very effective healer. Just because she's so efficient in terms of her mana usage. I mean, it's like even when she's kind of sputtering out of mana, she's still like a better healer than Uther, so. Very, very mana efficient healer. So Sylvanas thinking about trying to take that mid-keep wall, not going to be able to do it. Meanwhile, the chase is on. May have stayed too long, did Wrestling Butcher Face, so not going to be able to get this turn in. They're missing Zul, so definitely can't fight here. And fantastically timed Iron Skin from Johanna. Waited to see the animation for the Stormbolt from Murden, then popped it. Did a little B-step to just let them know that, like, yep, I read that. Doing a little bit to get into the head of USC. But meanwhile, they now have Zul, so taking a fight here. Greymane getting awfully low, but Johanna very, very low, out of Morales' range. But Vile ends up going down. Johanna getting awfully low, just getting the heals in time. Don't know if they know that Greymane is there. I think they lost track of him, and Greymane going to sneak out of there with just very little life left. Rusty Butcherface, I think they're thinking about going core, yeah. I don't know if they're going to be able to do this. The timers, Vol is going to be up. But they do have a sizable advantage, so maybe they can survive any kind of onslaught. Morales also doesn't really have any mana. Going to be very difficult to pull this off, but with Zul, I think they may be able to do it. If we can just clear these minions here, it's going to give them skeletons, going to give them more push power on the core. So far, Hammer has gone down, but so has Greymane and Vala. Zul and Sylvanas go down, but the core is at 12%. Johanna and Morales still alive, only 9% left on the core. Don't know if they're going to be able to do it. 4%, 3%, Morales squirt guns the core, and that is going to be game. Wow. So that was a very, very ballsy attempt there at core. I mean, the respawn timers just were very, 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 very low. So, I mean, we saw everyone on USC able to come up fairly quickly and get into the fight and defend their core. But it was just barely enough. The sizable level lead that that Wrestling Butcherface had allowed them to finish off the core. I think the efficiency of Morales in terms of her mana usage, it was just enough to seal the deal. It was a little risky. I mean, could have exploded there and given USC a chance to come back, get back into the game, but that last squirt gun for Morales able to seal the deal. So congratulations to Wrestling Butcherface. They will take this 2-0. And I believe they moved to 4-3 in the Pro Division, so congratulations to them. And that is going to do it for me for tonight. I'm going to be casting three more matches tomorrow, three more Division One matches. Very much looking forward to that. Hope they're half as good as these matches tonight. So, anyway, that is going to do it for me. Thank you for watching. If you'd like to see more of my casting, please do subscribe. And that's going to do it. Thanks, guys.